we're going to end at 5:10, so just a slight delay. While everyone's collecting here, I want to say as a non oceanographer, I realized my primary qualification for moderating the session is that I now teach John Slater's former introductory geology course, undergraduate course. I just have to figure out how to work over it. Great. We have a gallery. We have a group from the last time. I was wondering if maybe we could start with a question from the top. Okay, they're quiet. I see somebody's dog. Okay, so we'll open it up to the floor. Start then.
Yeah, I just had a question about the substance curves for the backyard basins versus the seafloor study centers. Why are they so different? I know maybe this morning again, Karen was talking about the fact that there was pulsations and maybe that might be affecting it, or are there other reasons that you didn't stop?
I know they're different, and I didn't have any idea that if there's any we could look at quantitatively, because you basically had the subduction. It was episodic. I don't know if there was any consistency in terms of depth. There is some if you look at west across the Marianas, but it didn't appear to me that you could do anything quantitative.
I'm curious to know where we stand with depth versus age. Now, Dan showed some of the recent data. John, you said that it's cooling half space back 80 meters or so. And I thought you said that it accounts for the depths going further back. But when you look at what Dan showed, it's pretty hard to see that through the other data, I thought. This is the recent data by Hogard and Nibuet and all of them, just a year ago.
Yeah, that's something I have with bacteria. And let's just accept what we've got as kind of an overview of what's happening. And now we'll look at the stuff that doesn't fit, which of course is itself is really interesting. And we've really worried for ever since Barry and I looked at the thing. If you go out to older ages, okay, and you look at you construct the thermal model that would explain the heat flow data, and then one that will explain the depth data, you can never get them really to fit. Now, Dan made a bunch of things that was really great, is that he was able to thin the plate. The problem is what matches the depths, okay, doesn't match the heat flow because the heat flow is too high. But even now, and this was stuff that I did with a couple of people who were here and were through it before, is it still, that difference is still there. And when I, even taking the stuff that you've done there, it was clearer than the models that you put up, but when you look at the depth data, the heat flow data as you go right towards the end, there's a kind of a curve that goes upwards. And if you look at it in terms of looking at it, tens of millions, well, it's not hard, it's up. Maybe 10 milliwatts or 50.
Right at the end, it's flat.
No, it's not. It's not flat. It stays flat, but there's a definite increase. There's kind of an increase in the heat flow, whereas in fact the depth is still going down. Dan, you have an answer.
We have a word here. What you say about the heat flow is correct. Right at the end, it's coming up. But that's twice the thermal time constant. So that is the time, if the deflection from the hot space model is correct, and that's because it's going on convective instability, the time you would expect that convective instability should show through a heat flow would be at 120 million years. The problem with depth age periods is that in the Western Pacific, there are just so many sea mounts. That causes trouble. In the other oceans, you're right up against the continent. So it's all a question as to what whether you know the thickness of the sediments near the continents. Yes, yeah. And we did our best and looked at, as far as Alistair and I could see, that that actually the behavior of the Pacific was reproduced in the other oceans. So I don't actually see that there's a problem yet, but the issue which is essentially unclear, I think, is what is the form of that convective instability that occurs. There are deviations, you know, in the further deviations in depth age, and we haven't yet got a satisfactory general convective model of what's going on. And this I find completely astonishing, because it's been perfectly possible now for 20 or 30 years on large computers to do the same tank experiments as we did in the lab. I've been unable to find anyone who's done that. So finally, we were put out of business by the large computers in the States in the 80s. But now the computers have got so big that John Rudge and I have gone back to doing some tank experiments on the computer, with the great virtue that you can calculate the gravity and the topography and the melting rates. We're just beginning a study of this. Why somebody hasn't done that before now, I don't know. We just got so that we don't know what the simplest possible model looks like.
Students out there listening? Ian, is that close?
Well, I would recommend graduate students to do it just straight away, because we've actually finished, we just haven't got the thing done and written up yet. But I mean, I don't want to feel in competition with a graduate student. On a thesis, you're going to do 3 years for a thesis. It's been totally obvious to do for 30 or 40 years, and no one's done it. This is not the time to recommend this to take this on. Right.
I will say the students came to me and said they are doing the wax tank experiments. They're all getting together, so get ready for that. Jennifer and James.
Professor Walker, you mentioned for the first time the San Andreas in this colloquium, and I think it's really interesting that they were struggling with reconciling the San Andreas fault offset with the Mayo geos, and I think in 1908 when they published the Larson report, they knew that there was a massive rebound on the San Andreas fault. So can you, or anybody want to participate in just describing what was going on in parallel with the land geophysicists looking at these large obvious structures, and how did that evolution come about to link up and discredit Miami Geo's synclines? Did it have to wait for, what was going on in that time?
Look, I will defer to somebody that was around a bit longer than I was.
But when you were talking about this conference at Stanford, yeah, where they were trying to reconcile this?
Well, the conference was sort of totally lopsided, because they had all these different, it was astonishing, because they had from all sorts of different fields, and the one that I picked out happened to be talking about zoogeography or something. And basically, all these people got together and they said, look, it has to be offset, and clearly, hopefully you people have visited the San Andreas Fault, and when you go up through the Kuritsa Plains and Parkfield and stuff, I mean, it's just, and if you go up to Mount San Jacinto and Palm Springs, I mean, it's just a dashed line on the ground. There's no offset, there's no vertical, things, and so it couldn't possibly fit into the preconceived ideas about geosynclines.
I would just say a word. The problem which completely foxed us was that there were these enormous east-west transport which had no earthquakes on them, with an offset of 1,000 kilometers, which ran into the continental margin and didn't displace it. How in the world could you do that? The San Andreas was active, but it was oblique to all this, and it was along the continental margin. So how did that fit in with anything? It was just complete mystery, complete muddle. I couldn't see it.
So I heard a couple of things in your talks, one of which was NSF, NASA, and various other funding sources declining. I also heard the point about students not going on ships. And I wanted to hear from the panel, since there are five of you sitting there, about what you think the future is for ship-based research and for pushing forward some of these ideas that you've been discussing. Because I think there are students out here who would like to know.
Well, I'll start out because I forgot to show my final slide, but basically I paraphrased Charles Dickens because 1968 was the best of times and the worst of times. You know, the funding was abundant, and as they said, you know, you didn't even have to worry about writing a proposal because, you know, there's this huge sort of blank check from ONR for scripts and Lamont was told just to go out and collect data. But maybe we shouldn't forget is that at the same time there was the assassination of Martin Luther King and Robert Kennedy and the Watts riots, and there was war in Vietnam going on. And I can't say that, I would say the best of times were long over. And I have to admit that I'm rather pessimistic.
I'm much more optimistic. I came here in 1969, as a reason to point out. My career here was shaped by tragedies of various sorts in the
post.
Okay, I arrived here in 69. It's a very tragic time in scripts. My memory of it centered on the fact that many of the classical students, incoming graduate students at various disciplines, were sent off to Vietnam. It was the time of peak conscription. I spent many days on the top of the cliffs at Torrey Pines, tears and irons, thinking about the students that we lost. As many of them did not come back. Best friends. It was also a tragic year immediately followed the loss of the submarine Scorpion in the North Atlantic. That had a big positive effect for me because the physical act, which up until 2 years previously had been called California Division of War Research, got massive influx of funding specifically for deep water surveying and scanning the seafloor, partly but not entirely find the Scorpion that he was trying to launch across the threshold. So to the extent that war is likely now, there may be an influx of ONR funding coming. Now, I came to Scripps because I wanted to use the vehicle that I'd heard of when I was at Cambridge, which was green physical labs, Deeptopia, species, invented. And it seemed to me the first time I could do detailed geomorphology on the ocean floor, because it used high resolution systems with innovation that they were lower just above the seafloor, so real high resolution view and some sonars. And I worked almost entirely with the DECO system, my thesis in the first 10 years I was here. But I soon realized that the greater advantage of working on the Fred's piece with near problem systems there's a really close contact between the marine physical lab and the U.S. Navy, especially the submariners in San Diego, all of whom Greer speaks, because he was a very successful submarine commander in World War II. Two, because he'd written a manual about proper, best way to accurately aim torpedoes to sink ships. And that is still a Bible that all the submariners that I've ever talked to use in submarine school. And all it took was Fred's piece to recommend me to the Navy in San Diego, and immediately offered free submersible time with Navy research submersibles all the way from Seacliff to Guest to work on the seafloor. That was how we got the first submersible device. The Bryant hydrothermal vents, hydrothermal windows, and for that point. So, we're indebted to Fred's peace relations from the US Navy. I really hope and making tentative efforts without species presence is going to be difficult. So if we can reopen the connection between the submarine Navy in San Diego and Fred's peace and Scripps and Scripps students. It got a little tricky for me after I arrived. Several tricky things happened. First, the graduate department here would accept me before I'd done my final exams and payment. But after I arrived, they insisted I take a test of English as a foreign language, which I refused to do. And they said, oh, okay, fair enough. And then when Ronald Reagan down here, he abolished secret clearances for all aliens. People who evidently needed to test a foreign language, test English as a foreign language, including. And so I lost much of my abilities to work with the submarine in San Diego.
Okay, I have some comments because that last part of Peter's brings up my past. Of course, you wouldn't believe this, okay? But here am I, 26-year-old Scott, okay? I didn't even know if it was English or not, but the Scott, I come here, and within 2 years, because they wanted me to get into MPL without having to come out and take me in, I have security clearance. And you know, it was amazing. But one of the advantages of that is we got down there and we could actually look, and it has a point to this, is that we could actually get to see what was available in terms of doing things. And you had access to up to small, relatively small ships. Okay? And there was a number, I think at one point, ships had 7 vessels. Now, the advantage for that is that the opportunities for going to sea became larger. And if you were actually willing to go to one of the ships, and you know, a couple of them were very unpleasant. Okay, one of them was the sister ship of the Pueblo. All guys know the Pueblo. Ours was called the Rolling Agony. And a lot of us believe that, in fact, the poor guys who got shot up actually were in Korean waters because they wanted to get out of the war. You know, nobody would actually have the guts to say so. But it was a small ship. Okay, the fact that there weren't too many graduate students, and we actually could, like Dan did, or you could just pick these things up in terms of the cruises that you were on. And they really, in reality, if you looked at it from the point of view of the professors, they actually had more ship time than they knew what to do with. So in fact, that we ended up being very to see. And of course, all of them, almost all of them, having been ex-Navy people or ex-Navy officers, they were greatly in favor of you actually going to sea. And that really helped. And it also, as I realized, helped me in Britain because my supervisor was Morris Hill. And of course, he did a lot of work at sea, some of which even now is not in his during the war. And which is, we don't even know what he was at, but it's actually done. It's just that he became a fellow of the Royal Society based on it. So when the presumption was that it was really important. that's my experience. But here again, on the ships, was stressed the seaboard part of it. But the question is now, if you look at the size of the boats, okay, it's kind of like the physics problem that Dan and I once discussed, the physics problem, and the real reason as to why we didn't go into physics. I mean, I wasn't really smart enough, Dan really was, but we looked at the problem and said, heck, if you're going to do physics, you're going to have to work as a combined group of a number of people to get anywhere. And I think that's the same thing that's happened in a lot of portions of ocean, not all of it, but a lot of portions of oceanography, is in order to be able to do something, you have to get together as a group, okay? And then go to sea and plan things out ahead. That's kind of difficult for me to think that I would really want to do that. Maybe I'm just too much of a stubborn obstinate Scot. I don't know, I go back to history.
Well, I recall you were the second Scotsman admitted to Cambridge's.
Well, there's a lot of famous Scotsmen. I mean, Clark Maxwell was a Scot. In fact, he partially funded the patent.
There's one thing that you haven't mentioned, which is that there is now, you may have shipped them, but there's an absolute mass of data.
Yes, I'm sorry.
And the internet lets you look at all kinds of problems with nothing more complicated than the computer that I use to project, which actually is the most powerful one I possess simply because it's the most recent one, but I could do all the calculations I've ever done on that little computer on data which I can download from the internet. And this is, for people my age, like John, who went around with the great boxes of cards that had almost no information on each card. So you've got to press a button and download gigabytes of data. All real data off the sea. That is an immense resource which is open to you. And that we didn't have, because we had to travel to the launch, reproduce all those cards and carry back.
And don't drop them.
You know, on that note, we are just got to 5:10 and there's social hour waiting for us outside. So we can thank